Good people of the audience, I commend you for your fortitude, for staying the distance, and I thank you. May I kindly ask you to take your seats. I hope you have been replenished. Who ate an Italian pastry in that last break? Who ate more than one Italian pastry? You're so proud, aren't you? You're so proud. Okay, all right. Are we all good? Are we all here? Are we all ready and fired up for the very last home stretch of this epic event in which you have been brilliant to be with us and the speakers have been brilliant to have condensed all of their excellence into but a few minutes? And that is going to be the case for this fantastic last panel, really fantastic. We're going to pick up and highlight one of the themes, one of the issues that has come up time and time again, the importance of raising awareness among coastal and among urban citizens about the threat to our ocean and waters, bringing them into the fold. That was the words we heard yesterday. Citizen science, engagement, engagement in protection, engagement in restoration, engagement full stop. So we're looking at kids and young people, so that they grow up understanding well what is at stake, how they can be part of all sorts of solutions. So just coming here, and then I will seat you, it's my great pleasure to ask to join me three brilliant schools project signatories of the Mission Charter. I'm not supposed to have favorites of panels or sessions, but actually this one's kind of going to prove to be my favorite, I think. Can I please welcome Rosalba Giugni from Marevivo, which is a non-profit organization with more than 36 years of experience in the protection of the sea and its resources. So I will put you, where can you go? Can you kindly, this seat, if you will. Thank you very much. So a warm welcome to you, Rosalba. Can I also welcome Danae Patsiou, who is here to talk about schools against plastics from the Hellenic Centre for Marine Research, which is the Greek national agency in charge of the study and the monitoring of the marine and fresh waters. So come, you are going to tell us more. And also a very, very warm welcome to Rebecca Katsaris, and she is going to bring to life increasing marine environment awareness via creative arts. What could be more fun at the end of a very long event, from the Enalia Physis Environmental Research Centre, which is Cyprus's leading NGO on marine sciences. So I think you will agree, this is a really splendid kind of conversation to have right at the very end. Now, Rosalba is extremely experienced. I said to you that Marevivo is an environmental association, independent, working for a very, very long time, since the mid-80s, for the protection of the sea and the environment. And I mean in a very, very holistic way. This lovely lady here, Rosalba, is Neapolitan by birth, Roman by adoption, a self-taught diver, and has always been passionate about the sea. So really seeing the first signs so long ago of plastic pollution during a dive in Capri. So, fantastic. Let's hear from you, please. And I'm going to put these on because our first speaker will speak in Italian.
Parlo in Italian. Grazie, grazie mille. C'è un video che appunto gli parlerò sopra perché ho pochi minuti e non li voglio sprecare. Qui nel mio video vedete un po' quelle che sono anche le nostre azioni. Ma io vi voglio dire una cosa molto, molto confortante, perché io faccio questo da 40 anni e 40 anni finalmente c'è un'atmosfera diversa, finalmente si parla delle cose, finalmente io andavo a pulire le spiagge e mi dicevano la signora non capiva niente di plastica, non capisce niente, la plastica è solo brutta, antiestetica, la signora è una casalinga del mare. E quindi è inutile che fa tutto questo lavoro. Ecco, abbiamo visto che la plastica adesso nel nei tessuti della placenta delle donne, nel latte e nel materno che noi diamo la plastica ai bambini. Ma ecco, io intanto voglio ringraziare tutti, perché questa atmosfera, questa cosa ci dà una forza per continuare e per fare le cose, perché sennò ci fermiamo. Guardate che è talmente brutto quello che c'è intorno che ci fermiamo, invece questi momenti sono indispensabili. E poi scusatemi, ditemi, l'Europa è prima nel mondo a fare tutte queste leggi, a fare tutti questi i fondi, perché dobbiamo cambiare, insomma, è fantastico. Allora io quello che voglio dire velocemente è che noi abbiamo presentato per la missione due progetti molto importanti. Uno è stato presentato da Geneviève Pont, che era quello della Martina Stella di Mare, che dei bambini dai 3 ai 6 anni, con un bellissimo volume che fa stimolare la creatività dei bambini, e quello è bellissimo. Insieme abbiamo anche fatto un altro progetto che si chiama Replant, cioè ricostituire le foreste del mare. Certo è un grande sogno, perché non le possiamo ricostituire, però è un modo per fare un'attività che noi parte dalla prevenzione. Noi non dobbiamo distruggere la prosidonia, la cistosera, la cimodocea, tutte quelle bellissime parti vegetali del nostro mare che ci fa vivere. Ecco, queste sono due azioni che noi abbiamo presentato alla missione, che stanno andando bene e sta perfetto. Però insieme noi facciamo attività con i bambini delle scuole delle isole minori. Il programma si chiama Delfini Guardiani delle Isole. E poi per quelli più grandi, che sono i nautici, i ragazzi nautici in blu. E io vorrei, scusami Catherine, di dire ai ragazzi nautici che sono qui presenti, se vi alzate un attimo in piedi, perché sono tutti ragazzi che hanno fatto il nostro corso. E con il preside, con gli insegnanti e con i nostri animatori, con i nostri esperti hanno fatto questo corso, che dicono che gli ha cambiato la prospettiva, perché noi dobbiamo prima di tutto dobbiamo cambiare il nostro modo di pensare, il nostro modo di vedere il mondo, perché noi non abitiamo a Palermo, a New York, noi abitiamo sul pianeta Terra, e questo è molto importante, noi abitiamo sul pianeta Terra. Ecco, ultimamente qui è stato chiuso appena pochi giorni fa un corso sulla plastica, con plastic, adesso non mi ricordo bene come si chiama, comunque è con 900 bambini, e continuiamo. Però io vorrei chiudere, prima che i miei 4 minuti finiscano, che noi stiamo partendo con una grande campagna che si chiama Only One, One Planet, One Ocean, One Health. Tutta è una salute, la salute nostra e quella degli oceani, quelli tutti gli esseri che vivono sul pianeta devono stare in armonia. Un'armonia che ci ha impiegato 4 miliardi di anni perché noi potessimo vivere su questo pianeta, e la stiamo distruggendo. Questa campagna sarà a bordo dell'Amerigo Vespucci, nave che ci ha messa a disposizione la Marina Militare Italiana, che si dicono che è la più bella nave del mondo, e il Palinuro, sono le due navi a vela, a navi scuola. E con questa campagna, con una mostra a bordo, andremo dappertutto. Naturalmente questa mostra è a vostra disposizione, a disposizione di tutti chi la vuole e ci vuol fare, perché è uno strumento importantissimo, perché parla della crisi climatica nella quale siamo immersi tutti. E che cosa dobbiamo fare? Dobbiamo fare una transizione ecologica, dobbiamo smettere di bruciare materiali fossili, dobbiamo andare verso le rinnovabili, dobbiamo fare una transizione alimentare, non ci possiamo più alimentare così, dobbiamo cambiare stile di vita, e poi l'economia circolare. Tutto quello che produciamo deve avere una vita per sempre, come fa la natura, tutto crea e tutto trasforma, e non ci sono rifiuti. Ecco, con questa campagna noi vogliamo andare dappertutto, parlarne con tutti, perché tutti devono essere consapevoli, perché non si può fare una transizione ecologica se non c'è una transizione culturale. Quindi tutto quello che io ho sentito oggi va tutto in questa direzione, e io dico sempre, e chiudo, che il nostro futuro dipende dalla salute del mare, ma la salute del mare dipende dalle nostre azioni. Quindi grazie e avanti tutta. Grazie.
You are unutterably the best kind of speaker to have right at the end of an event, because if any of you were flagging, you ain't. flagging now, that is for sure. Brilliant, brilliant. One quick question. You talked about, and we heard from Genevieve Pons earlier, about the project for 3 to 6-year-olds. Is there any one quote that came out of the mouth of anybody that little that struck you when they, you know, they are able to be part of this awareness, this sensibilization? Anything?
Guarda, più che la frase è la meraviglia, perché I bambini si meravigliano del nostro meraviglioso pianeta. Quindi quando tu gli racconti le storie di come funziona, di come ogni animale è in collaborazione con un altro, I bambini si meravigliano e rimangono incantati. E questa è la cosa che poi perdono negli anni. E noi vediamo, siccome facciamo con I bambini di 3 anni, quelli delle elementari, quelli delle medie, e poi siamo passati anche ai ragazzi del Diamond Teaching Blue, che sono ragazzi liceali, allora tu vedi che ogni età ha qualcosa, ma quelli piccoli hanno la meraviglia di capire e sono affascinati da questo mondo incredibile nel quale viviamo.
Thank you so much, and isn't that the trick, that we hold on to our wonder? That's the trick, isn't it? Thank you. If there are any questions, just momentarily, I will just allow the other two ladies, let me ask you to lay out your stall, so to speak. So you are a postdoctoral researcher, as I said, Danae, at the Hellenic Centre for Marine Research. So lots of work around assessing the environmental impacts of microplastics on the marine environment and toxicology in aquatic species. Very, very interested in this science, in this outreach to citizens. So you're going to talk about this latest project, Schools Against Plastic, citizen science projects funded by BMED and HCMR. So this is primary school oriented, is
yes.
that right?
Yes, it's okay. Primary schools.
So let's hear more, thank you.
Thank you for including me in this panel. So in this project, the Schools Against Plastics, so the HCMR scientists collaborate with two primary schools in Greece from two distinctively different areas, representative of light and heavy anthropogenic activity. The goal of the project is to engage students to environmental sciences and raise awareness for plastic pollution in marine environments. So through this project, actually, the students have the opportunity to become scientists for a day and do the job that we do when we go to the beach and monitor for plastic litter and microplastics. In this project, we created a toolkit. If you can move to the next slide, please. So you can see the toolkit. It's a box, and it has inside like a portable, easy using equipment. For example, it has a stereoscope, a portable stereoscope, some sieves, some scale, reusable bags and petri dishes and things like that. So the students can actually take to the beach and collect plastic litter and search for microplastics in the sand and collect some marine organisms to investigate ingested microplastics. So through the when the students actually collect the plastic litter, they see the products from which the litter comes from, and actually they recognize the products, they can see the plastic footprint, and they can see how the plastic ends up in the oceans. Then we sieve the sand and we find the microplastics in the sand. Then we collect the marine organisms. In our case, we collected sea urchins. The laboratory work has been done in our laboratories in HCMR, but the students had the opportunity to see, to take a measurement of the size. And actually, in one case, we saw sea urchins that were covered by plastic litter. So the students had the opportunity actually to see by their own eyes how animals can be exposed to plastic. So if we move to the next slide, please.
You can take your time, it's okay.
Yeah.
It's all right.
So the second part of the activity is to go back to the classroom that it's actually transformed in a laboratory, and then we see the students see the microplastics that they have collected under the stereoscope. They take notes of the color, the size, and the shape of the microplastics. I think that's all. What we've seen so far is that the students and the teachers are very enthusiastic about this work. We have been collaborating very nicely together, and we really hope this actually will be a continuous project. We believe that through this project and actually other projects like this that are presented in this panel, that we can help shape environmental values in the young people, and for the older ones maybe to help them reconsider a bit some harmful lifestyles and prioritize the environmental protection.
Yeah. Thank you. That's a very nice way. I mean, very articulate. Help shape environmental values. And I suppose before I move to you, Rebecca, the question remains the same. I mean, what sort of reactions, you said, or comment do you have? I mean, obviously, when you say you've got the sea urchin, you've got the plastic, it's ooh. Have you been surprised by any of the feedback or the responses of any of the kids?
What I've seen is that actually, in the start, they are afraid of the sea urchins, for example. They are like, all the spikes and I'm not touching this. But then they see it with different eyes and they are actually, they care for it at the end. And that's amazing. They actually see the problem by themselves.
Thank you. I'm going to start with a question for you, Rebecca, something a bit different. How do we keep that feeling of wonder beyond the classroom? How do we...
We have to add lots of sparkles.
Lots of sparkle action.
Well, through... we have to find creative ways.
Yeah.
And always be on our toes.
Yeah. And creative ways for those who are not just this age, but and beyond. To bring, as we said when we were in Hamburg, to bring the ocean into the workplace, into the homes, and not just the classroom. But tell us, so you are a preschool educator and have a lot of experience in designing and creating and putting into practice programs and material, educational material that focuses on environmental issues and intercultural issues. So there's all sorts of ways that you integrate all sorts of kinds of learning methodologies. So we're talking from music to gastronomy to storytelling to dance. So tell us more about a particular project.
Of course. Good afternoon to everyone. It's a real honor to be here. I'm very excited. Thank you for giving me the floor to talk about our project. I will quickly start with explaining the journey that I am on at the moment with an NGO called Enalia Physis Environmental Research Center. We've been working together since 2018. Allow me to describe the journey. It's been quite fascinating. So together we put a very powerful group of marine scientists, music educators, writers, illustrators, storytellers, puppeteers, and together we created books for children, which we then turned into audiobooks, e-books, experiential workshops, interactive storytelling, and puppet shows. So, all related to marine environmental hot issues such as priority protected habitats and species, seagrass meadows, sea turtles, sea mammals, etc. And talking about the threats that they are facing, coastal development, unsustainable fishing and touristic practices, and so on. At the same time, we propose solutions. So why do we think that as our project has been successful up until now? The children, through these creative processes, they get the chance to compose music inspired by the singing, the song and dance of the monk seals, create and compose their own rap songs, interact with the storytellers, interact with the puppeteers, ask questions. They also get to opinionate, you know, and propose solutions, which, as we all, I think we all agree, that provides a sense of ownership, making the children feel that they can propose solutions and be part of the solution. Currently, our project is being funded by the Cyprus Environment Foundation, and on behalf of the foundation and our NGO, we would like to invite everyone to join forces with us, exchange ideas, see what kind of work we can do together to reproduce, scale up our project. And I would like to warn you that there's someone else here with us. It's God Poseidon, and he wants to make sure that we're all going to follow up all the promises that we've been making. So watch out, everybody. He's everywhere, all around the Mediterranean. I would like to thank everyone. It's been a fantastic event. Thank you, Katrina, for hosting. It was incredible. And I would like to dedicate to everyone a lovely rap song that a group of children created back in Cyprus with their teachers. Thank you. So if we can click the icon with the megaphone, enjoy. On the right hand side. That's another composition that I would like to share with you. We can turn the volume up if that's okay, Katrina.
We can turn the volume up, please. That would be great. If you can hear us, you can turn the volume up. That's good.
So it's saying, save the monk seals, save the sharks. We had the contribution of an amazing violinist from Cyprus, Nikos Pitas. I would like to thank him as well. I could translate. It's basically saying, get your litter out of the sea, save the monk seals, save the sea. These are the lyrics. The children come up with the lyrics. We don't tell them what to say. We just record on the spot at school. And then we play the song to the children so they feel proud. And they ask, is it going to be on YouTube? So okay. They have their own composition. And we gift it to the whole school community.
Brilliant. Thank you. Thank you. We really needed that now. Can I take one... Can I take one more minute with these lovely people? Just one. What, yes, we had one intervention and then a quick question. Go for it. Yes.
Grazie. Intanto volevo dire dell'Italia. In Italia noi abbiamo una bellissima legge, la legge salvamare.
Ah, there's no microphone.
In Italia abbiamo una bellissima legge, la legge salvamare, che Marevivo ci ha messo 4 anni per poterla avere, 4 anni. Però non abbiamo I decreti attuativi e stiamo lavorando per avere I decreti attuativi. È una legge che consente ai pescatori di riportare a terra la plastica che ha trovato nelle reti. Attualmente è trasporto illecito di rifiuti. Pensavamo in 3 mesi di avere questa legge, ci abbiamo messo adesso 5 anni. E poi in questa legge c'è che di mettere lo sbarramento ai fiumi per raccogliere la plastica prima che arrivi in mare. Che queste sono cose importantissime. E poi io chiudo dicendo... che abbiamo lanciato al Ministero della Pubblica Istruzione, qui abbiamo un direttore generale,
per fare obbligatorio nelle scuole insegnare che cos'è il mare, perché è il mare che fa vivere il pianeta. E quindi questo lo sanno a tutti i livelli, dai piccoli fino alle università, tutti devono sapere, i docenti. E quindi questo è importante. E quei due progetti che avete visto, che sono stati inseriti, sono della nostra delegazione del Friuli Venezia Giulia, dove c'è qui Cristina Pedicchio, che è la nostra delegata e che è appassionatissima, poi ne continuerà a parlare lei. E comunque vi voglio ringraziare, perché questa cosa delle leggi è importantissima, perché noi possiamo dire ai bambini, e i bambini ci sono, perché i bambini sono con noi, però diventano grandi, e allora dobbiamo trovare il modo di fare delle leggi perché ci siano delle regole comuni condivise da tutti per salvare il mare. Grazie.
Thank you. Because we have a bit... No, you're good. Oh, no. I would... No. Please stay. We have just a special moment, actually, now. So don't go away. We have another celebration coming at a very nice time at our event in collaboration with the Italian Ministry of Education. This time, Blue Champion schools that are bringing the ocean into the classrooms. We're going to meet some pupils. Please do come round as well. Please do come round. Hello. Buongiorno. Hello. Stay here. Stay here. Little bit this way. Okay, get them to move along. Here. Okay. Okay. Hello. Buongiorno. Hello. Hi. Okay. Kestutis, John, I think you should be part of the picture here, please. The most photographed gentleman at this event. Here. Please carry on. They need to feel so welcome. If you want to keep clapping, it would be lovely. There we go. Here we go. All right. Ah, hold that. Voila. You can put the music up a bit. We can have some more applause, I think. Great, okay, the music can continue. We'll get, great, thank you so much for being a part of our photograph. So there we go, right. You know what I'm gonna ask you, ladies and gentlemen, can you bring your energy up for a last round of applause for these great young people? Bravo. Bravo and brava. Okay. Thank you. Grazie mille. Thank you so much. Grazie. Thank you. Thank you. You were all lovely. What would this event have been without all of these delightful, thank you, grazie, 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 grazie mille, look at you, you're gorgeous, you're all gorgeous. Okay, bye, bye, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, you're brilliant, thank you, grazie, thank you, thank you. Thank you, all of you. You can take your seats. Thank you so much. Thank you. You're great. Thank you. you're lovely. Thank you. And can we just do, I know you're tired, but hey, you've been sitting on your bums and at least you're going to have fantastic biceps by the end. Can we please give a warm round of applause to those last three wonderful speakers? Thank you. Thank you so very much, Rosalba, Danae, and Rebecca. A really nice session to have right at the end. Okay, we are approaching the end. We have two last speakers. It's good to hear from them. Okay, so the first of those is MEP Tonino Picula, who is at the group of the Progressive Alliance of Socialists and Democrats, but importantly, chair of SEARICA, the Seas, Rivers, Islands and Coastal Areas Intergroup, which brings together more than 100 MEPs from 7 different political groups and 23 member states. So may I ask our MEP to please join us? There you are. There you are. I hadn't met you before. Look, you get to go up the important stairs again. Thank you. Welcome.
What to say? Thank you for giving this opportunity, but my personal opinion that we need to end this conference 5 minutes ago with our kids, of course. We need to give a future a chance.
It's tough to follow that, yeah. Isn't it? It's a tough one.
Okay. But thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, cari amici, thank you for staying with us up until this conclusion, but late point of our event. I sense that you feel very informed, inspired, but very exhausted too. Therefore, I will keep my intervention short. I want to start by thanking everyone for the substantial discussions of the whole day. Just to present myself, I'm both Mediterranean and Islander, coming from Adriatic coast, from the very last country which became member state, Croatia. So I'm happy to see the prominent role and recognition the islands and islanders have been bringing this mission forward. Back in 2016, together with two islanders' colleagues, one from Malta and one from Sicily, Michela Giuffrida from Catania, we proposed a pilot project on energy transition of EU islands that was approved by the European Commission. 7 years later, the project is official part of Green Deal. We have a running secretariat providing technical assistance to more than 60 islands from all over Europe, including Sicily. This is the best example how islands can generate innovative solutions and lead the European Union towards climate neutrality. Today, I'm also greeting you on behalf of the SEARICA Intergroup of the European Parliament. My primary message today is to support the mission and your work thoroughly. I can say that on behalf of more than 100 members of the European Parliament from 23 countries. Now, that's really mean something. We share many of the concerns mentioned earlier, but we also share the enthusiasm and hope they were the common denominators of our talks today. The EU missions have a vital role in the sustainable future of Europe. They are critical enablers of the EU Green Deal. And we are well aware that the pressure and threats on the ocean have intensified in the past decades. We must now dedicate much more political attention and financial support to sustainable exploitation of marine ecosystems and their resources. Besides encouraging research, we need the right tool and support for technical innovations and citizens' engagement to shape sustainable future for the ocean. This is what EU mission's objectives are about. It's about breaking the silos and going beyond that has existed before to bring concrete solutions together to one of the most significant challenges for the future of the Europe. In the mission's ecosystem, European Parliament has a peculiar responsibility and the direct representative of EU citizens. At the European Parliament level, SEARICA has pioneered these collaborative visions for the ocean. Starting in 2009, the Intergroup has been a forum of broad exchanges to learn from actors on the ground and call for place-based and knowledge-based maritime policies. Since then, SEARICA Intergroup has continued giving political impetus to oceans challenges in alignment with the EU mission Oceans objectives. In the past 3 years, we addressed many challenges, such as coastal erosion, sea level rise, marine litter, underwater noise, climate adaptation, coastal resilience, and more. We bring European Union national and regional players around the same table, similar to what you set up today. We did a lot, but we wish to do even more running towards the end of the mandate. We want our nature, our seas, our oceans restored. We need citizens' engagement now more than ever when the concrete legislative proposals to enable that's being very challenged. Today, I reaffirm the commitment of the SEARICA Intergroup and my commitment as the chair of the Intergroup to offer space for a political voice of the ocean at the EU level. In that respect, we will remain attentive to the European Commission evaluation of the missions. Call on them also to maintain the political and financial support needed for excellent deployment of the EU mission Ocean. The future of the ocean's health is the future of EU citizens' health. We owe it to ourselves and the future generations. On that role, special thanks to the schools and the students for their inspiring actions. You are the source of inspiration and assurance that this mission is in safe hands. I will not keep you longer from enjoying your evening in Palermo. The best ideas are constantly created after the formal program, as we all know. Sincere thanks to everyone again, and good luck.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. And important, very useful to get insights into that intergroup. So thank you, and for condensing those insights so beautifully. Now, it's never hard for me to give the almost last words before I just close proceedings to a fellow female speaker. So please, can you join me? You will be also ascending the stairs. We have Mission Board member Maria Cristina Pedicchio. So thank you. A last warm round of applause.
So thank you very much for the invitation to close this 2 days, fantastic 2 days. We have heard many, many beautiful projects. It's our responsibility now to try to scale up and mainly to make good use of all the networking and friendship that we developed in these 2 days. But I want to remind some key words. First things, big challenge. The big challenge that came out from what we have said in 2 days is mainly one: how can we balance the blue economy, the growth, the skills, with the ecological aspect, with sustainability? This is a big challenge. This is a big problem that came out everywhere. How can we construct trust between economy and ecology? One tool could be to use more the scientific community. And here I want to mention the three horizontal enablers of the Starfish mission. The first one is digitalization. And I want to remind you what digital twins are. The President von der Leyen has mentioned many, many times that all Europe must develop before 2030 digital twins of European seas and oceans. What is digital twin? Very simply, it's clearly a digital, virtual copy of our seas, of the Gulf of Trieste, of the Sicily Channel, or whatever you want. Not easy, very complicated. But our scientists are able to do it. Clearly, it's a multidisciplinary effort. You have to put together computer science, big data specialists, biologists, oceanographers, and so on, to collect a huge amount of data. Then you have this copy, this virtual copy. What can you do with this? Then the policymakers or institutions that are here can and must use this tool to give answer to the what if question. That's the point. Spiros, what would be your what if question in Greece? What happens if sea level rise? Sorry, I'm asking and answering by myself. Somebody else could say, what happens if we stop fishing? What happens if there is an oil spill? What happens, our port authorities saying, if we do a dragage here, what happens? So with a digital twin, it's possible to build the different scenarios saying, if you do this, this will happen. If you do that, that will happen. And then the policymakers have a tool to take the correct decision that guarantee economic growth with respect of the environment. This is a big challenge. And this is a key word in the Starfish mission, use data, data, satellite, in situ, citizen science data, and so on. Other two keywords, very quickly. Second, extremely important, science diplomacy. We have been speaking, we have been talking about education, higher education, but science diplomacy is a key when we discuss about the Mediterranean basin, because we have to build a network of young talent people from all the Mediterranean countries. Science diplomacy, we have to remember this word. And again, with a digital twin, we were somehow constructing trust between economy and ecology. Now we must construct trust among people, among countries. We have many examples that have been presented in the mission charter where the results are extraordinary. And I apologize for the diplomat if there is any here in the room, but science diplomacy is such a strong tool, much stronger than classical diplomacy. Third keywords, citizen engagement, have been mentioned many, many times. That means that citizens must co-design, co-implement, co-evaluate, and mainly they must be involved in innovative ways. And we have seen art, music, kids. So here again, trust is a main point. We must build trust among citizens, the community, the policy, the scientific part. And we have seen, I've heard beautiful example of fishermen, the role of fishermen community to develop a good strategy for fishing, for aquaculture, that again is putting together ecology and economy, is putting together countries. Many, many challenges, but I think that from what we have heard, and mainly from the small kids that we have seen, they are giving us a lot of hope for the future, and so I'm sure that we will get all the results of the Starfish mission. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Brilliant, brilliant. Thank you very much for articulating, as we spoke earlier, those key enablers and for pulling those out and underlining them at the end of our event. And every mission board member I've met is so full of passion and brilliance. It's always a privilege. Thank you very much, Maria Cristina Pedicchio. So before I close proceedings, go on, because we're a little bit early. A last poll? Yes. Could we please do a last poll? So if I can ask our lovely technical crew to bring it up. After 2 days, I leave this event what? As you can see, only positive stuff. And then one little cheeky one at the end. Well-networked, stuffed full of useful information, stuffed full of excellent conference food. Come on, we're in Italy. I think we all have to agree that that's a given. Far better informed, stimulated and inspired, eager to get my hands on limoncello / delete apply as applicable. After 2 days, how do you leave this event? I know it was a big one. I know we have prevailed upon your eyes, ears and brains. I know. But still, we've done well if more than half of you are stimulated, motivated and inspired. Some good networking's gone on. And then, oh, look, yeah. Well, networking limoncello. They're both going together. Okay, there's no surprise there, I think. It's neck and neck. Okay, but the clear winner you come away certainly better off in spirit and knowledge than before you came to this event yesterday. And some of you have, I think, had some very good conversations for future potential cooperations. But I see that's the clue. I shouldn't keep you away too long from a glass of something cold. It's been an absolute pleasure and a privilege to be with you. You don't need any resume from me. The only thing I always think when I have the unutterable pleasure of listening to so many brilliant people is, my God, I mean, we have all of these solutions. We have all of these fantastically clever, gifted, willing people. And there's always that collaboration, cooperation element that comes in every single time. So I end with my favorite quote, which is the one of George Bernard Shaw, the author and philosopher, which is, "The single biggest problem in communication is the illusion that it has taken place." It's a good one. It requires energy to communicate, an awful lot of energy. And that came up time and time again in the polls. Keep everybody together, keep communicating. So thank you so much to our wonderful speakers. Can you give them a hand, please? Because thank you, thank you, thank you. Of course, you were wonderful, and I really dearly thank you for respecting the timing. You did well. I know you came to this event thinking, oh, I've got a lovely 15 minutes, and then you were kind of quickly disavowed of that, so thank you. Thank you to the organizers and the hosts, of course, the European Commission, the Italian government, the Sicily region, the University of Palermo, and the Blue Mission Med Coordination and Support Action. Fabio Fava, it's you. We're thanking you. So thank you to all. And Fedra. Yes, of course. And Fedra. Thank you very much. You are right. Indeed. Your arms are going to fall off. The interpreters, can we agree? They've done a magnificent job. There's a lot of action behind the scenes. The technical team have been grappling with storms and I don't know what. And this... So, to VO Europe, special thanks from me to Peter and to Harold, and for your robust logistical and just friendship support. And warm thanks, I haven't forgotten you, warm thanks to our audience for turning up and tuning in. And for those of you, you brilliant young people in the listening room, those of you from the Navy Institutes, I thank you very much. It was a lot to take in. I know you're going to hate me. Oh, go on. Sorry. A huge thanks to Claudia Pecoraro. Huge, huge. A mad job. You should stand, really, please. Come on. Really, please. An amazing job, truly. Thank you. I say this as a moderator of many events. She has been highly invested. I don't think she slept for God knows how long. And this was a big orchestration. As I joked, it was bigger than putting on La Traviata in, I don't know, Verona. Okay? So I thank you. You've been delightful. Really. Very good. Perfect. And as we say in English, there's no rest for the wicked, or non-wicked in your case, because the next mission event takes place during the ocean race in Genoa on the 26th of June. That's also, I think, your baby. Yeah, less epic than this, but your baby. Yeah. Do join, do spread the words to others who would find it useful to participate. That's in a month. Take a break. My head is fit to burst. But I do mean it as a moderator. It's been a privilege. I've learned a lot. I've been very happy to be among you. Thank you very much. I'll do a John. I'll do a curtsy. Thank you. Oh, thank you. God, that feels like, I feel like I've just performed at the opera in Verona. Thank you very much. That's very heartwarming. Thank you so much. I wish you all the safest trip back to where you came from. Very good luck in all of your future efforts. And now you can hit the limoncello. Voila, there you go. Grazie mille. Thank you very much.